Might have noticed in the schedule, those of you who haven't, we have an open problem session right after the coffee break, which is after Joel's mini course. And so please feel free to propose problems, well, especially problems related or somewhat related to the theme of the workshop. Okay, could maybe propose the Riemann hypothesis as well, but it's, I don't think anybody will solve it. And And we'll start this this event with a mini course by Professor Beltran from INCA and PUC in Peru. And he's going to be talking about the martingale approach to metastability.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for coming. So in this lecture, I will try to tell you what is the purpose of this course. For it, let me tell you what some examples of questions that I will try to answer along the course, questions that appear in metastability. So first, suppose that you have two arms. Arm one, arm two, and you have M balls in these arms. Okay, so now each time we choose a ball uniformly among the total of balls. And we move it to the other arm. Okay? And now let's observe the process that indicates the number of balls in arm one, for example. Okay? So everybody knows that this is a Markov process. The state space of this Markov process is the is the set of integer numbers from 0 to 1. And something special in this Markov process is that when you have a much larger number of balls, for example, at this arm one, the number of balls in R1 is larger than the number of balls in R2. So with a larger probability, with a very large probability, you will choose the ball in R1. So very, very clear. So in my for my process eta n, that means that if the process is at the right of the midpoint, the middle of this interval, then the process undergoes a drift pointing toward the middle. Of course, okay, this is clear. Analogously, if you are here, at the left of the midpoint, you will see that the process is pushing is pushing your position to the middle of the interval. Yeah? So we expect to see that if you start the process somewhere in a neighborhood of the middle of the interval, you will stay in this neighborhood for a very long time. I mean that when n goes to infinity, so for n very, very large, you will see that the process, that the number of balls in the two arms are almost equal. Yep. But for each n, this process is reducible. So someday, finally, you will see that you will escape from this neighborhood of the midpoint. Let me call this time Tn. Obviously, this time depends on the total number of balls. Good. So, so I'm saying that this Tn must be a very large time, a very long time. And then the question now, which is a common question in metastability, is if I rescale the time, if I speed up the process so that this time is of order one, the question is if I can prove that this rescaled time converges in law to an exponential distribution. Okay? And so the question here is, does it exist a time scale for which the escaping time, so let me call this escaping time, for n very, very large, this escaping time is asymptotically exponential distributed. Okay. Okay, good. So this is the kind of question that I will try to answer. So in a very short summary of the course, I will give you some techniques in order to prove the convergence to an exponential distribution. Very well. Let me show you another example. Yeah. Okay, for these examples, consider two cycles. So that here you have n vertices. N vertices at each cycle, okay? So let's call this the cycle one. Let's call this cycle two. And now we are joining these two vertices. Let me call this vertex V and this vertex W. And we join these two vertices with a bond. And now we consider a Markov process. On this graph with the following rates. Okay, suppose that in my Markov process, if you are here in one cycle, you can only jump to a neighboring vertex, okay? And the rate of each jump is 1. And the same for each pair of vertices inside the cycle. Except in this bond, I will say that the you can jump for this Markov process. You can jump from this vertex V to this vertex W with a rate which is converging to 0, which is vanishing. Let me put something like 1 over n to the gamma with some positive gamma. Okay, here again, n is a parameter going to infinity, n is very large, and this gamma is just a fixed parameter. Okay? Good. So here it's not very difficult to accept, to admit that when you everything is okay. Okay. When you start, for example, inside this cycle, once you reach this position, the probability that you jump to the other cycle is of order n to the minus gamma. So this probability is converging to 0. So if gamma is a large something, I don't know, 100, then this probability is too small. Okay, so depending on gamma, what we expect to see is that you will state will remain in the same cycle. For again a very, very long time. So again, it's the time which is diverging, which is going to infinity, as n is going to infinity. So here, and here, what we observe is that we have a subset of the state space from which it's very difficult for the Markov process to escape. Let me call this subset a well. And OK, in the course, I will be later precise about this concept as well. And here, in this example, these are now my wells, some subsets of the state space from which the Markov process is very difficult to escape. So here, these two subsets are, in some sense, wells for the dynamics. OK, so my techniques will permit me to prove this kind of asymptotic result when you are in this situation. So you have a well for the Markov process, and a well in which the Markov process will remain for a long, long, long time. And then suddenly, the Markov process escapes from this well. So this suddenly is described for this asymptotically exponential distribution. Good. So I will use this simple example now to explain the main features in metastability. The size of the letter is okay for you. You can read it. Yeah? Okay. So in metastability, you will always observe the existence of two or maybe more timescales over which the system shows different behaviors. For this example, if you see the process, the original process, then you see pseudo stability. You see that for someone who is observing this Markov process for n very, very large, he will believe that the process is just defined on this cycle, because he will never see that the process escapes from this cycle. So in this time scale, for my example, you observe a pseudo stability. Okay? So now let me tell you something. Suppose that you start your process here at this vertex, and now you want to know the expectation of the time starting from V to observe that the process reaches the position W. In this example, this is not difficult to compute this expecting time, the expectation of this time. And actually, this is the exact value of the expectation of this time is n to the gamma plus 1. OK, it's not a very difficult question. So this computation suggests that in order to observe the interwall dynamics, in order to examine how the process escapes from one well and goes to the other well, to another well, you need to speed up the process. And okay, maybe this is the right time scale, n to the gamma plus 1. Good. Okay. Another observation. Forget for a moment that you have two cycles. Suppose that you have just one cycle and you start inside this cycle. Okay? So you speed up your processes in n squared, you know that you will see inside the cycle, in the limit, as n goes to infinity, a Brownian motion in the circle, yes, in the continuous circle. This is what you will observe at this time scale n squared. You also know that n squared is precisely the order of the mixing time for each cycle. Yep? So another feature in metastability is that before you gamma is bigger than 1. I'm not assuming that. I'm going to assume it exactly that, because this, yes, the order of these three levels is right only if gamma is bigger than 1. So this is what I'm going to say right now. OK, so I'm putting that here, but maybe it's not here. That depends on the gamma. And this is what I'm going to say now. In metastability, You say that you are observing a metastability behavior if, before you escaping from the well, you observe that the system reaches a pseudo equilibrium. Okay, so the system reaches a pseudo equilibrium before escaping. So in order to see that the Markov process is escaping from this well, you need to speed up maybe this time this factor, yes, n to the gamma plus 1. So if you, in order to say that you are observing a metastability, you need to see this other, this another feature. So for this reason, I will assume here gamma bigger than 1. Okay, this is the necessary and sufficient condition to see now that these time scales are in the right order in my scheme, my graph. Yep. Okay. So when you are watching the process at these time scales, for this time scale, n squared is something very short. So it's something instantaneous. So if you read any paper, any book about metastability, you will read that the system reaches this pseudo equilibrium inside the walls instantaneously. But instantaneously at the right time scale, yes? The time scale in which you see this interwell dynamics. Okay, this is the right sentence. Okay, so let me put this A, this B. And now, when people study metastability, another thing that they want to prove is something like the same thing that I stated here. We would like to study the escaping times. We would like to see, to say that the system escaped from the well in a suddenly way. So this exponential distribution is the formal way in which we say that the system escapes is suddenly. So I would like to prove here, for this example, that when you observe the process, or when you scale the escaping times in this factor n to the gamma plus 1, this random time converges in law to an exponential distribution. Let me put that in the following terms. Look at the process, your Markov process on the graph, okay? And now observe, define the process which indicates the well in which the process is. Okay? Let me call this process the index process. Good. So now this is a process. No, it depends if you are in position E1 or E2. If you are in cycle, it's only one. Yes, it's always one. I'm sorry. let me put an I. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, so I now have a stochastic process over 1-2. It's okay? Over 1-2. And I say that this is a stochastic process because my observation here that this process is not Markov. You don't have the Markovian property here for this process. Let me put an N here because everything here depends on an N. And now, the main goal of this course is to try to prove, is to get good tools to prove that in the limit, you recover the Markov property. Okay. So in another context, you can also see this kind of result as a result of simplifying the system. I mean, you have this detailed process, which is the eta n, which is saying exactly the position of the Markov processes, and you have another process, which is a simplification of the original process. So this simplified process in the limit can be, I think it's very, very, very large. I'm saying that it can be approximated by a Markov process. Okay, and we'll try here, for example, it's not a very good question what are the rates, because the rates must be one for each transition. Yes, it's very easy to answer that, but we will see another example in which it's not too easy to obtain the rates of this Markov process limit. So, in particular, if you get this result, if you succeed to prove this kind of convergence, in particular, you will prove that these escaping times. I didn't escape my process, of course. If you define your x in this way, obviously you will. It's not so obvious, but okay, you will get that this process will converge to something which will stay in cycle one, for example, forever. So we need here to scale correctly the time, to rescale the time correctly. So let me put here. I forget that here you need to speed up your process. And I'm guessing that this is the right scaling time, or time scale. Sorry. So now this can be true. Okay, actually, it was true, but the Markov process was trivial, yeah? If you succeed to prove this kind of result, in particular, you will get you will prove that this time scaling, this time of escaping from each well is converging to an exponential distribution in law. Yep. But when you put this result, or you put your problem, you state your problem in these terms, in this way, that allows me to use the main tool. In this course, which will be the martingale problem. So this is this is what I will talk about tomorrow. Instead of observing just the times as random variables, I will observe this sequence of Markov processes, and we will try to prove the convergence of this Markov process. This is my first step in my approach. Okay. This is something that I will also be able to do here in this problem. Good. So now let me put these examples in a general setting, which will be our general setting in the course. So here I will, as you can see here in my examples, you have not just one Markov process, you have a sequence of Markov processes. Actually, I will assume that these Markov processes are irreducible. with, I will assume that all the state space are finite. I mean, as in my examples, but you see that the state space maybe is getting larger and larger, but this is always fine. Okay, this is not a very a strong thing. I can also suppose that they are, that the state space are countable, but okay, I will assume that it's finite and this will be enough to me, enough for me. Okay. So you will have a sequence of state space. And now, of course, depending on the precise Markov process, sequence of Markov process that you have, you will observe this kind of behavior, and your state space in your state space, it will be appear in naturally a partition, as in the case of the cycles. Partition where each part, each subset is a well. And the purpose here is, the goal here is to try to prove that the index process that I will define as the process telling you in which subset of this partition you are. Let me here fix let me fix some scaling time. Here we will speed up the process in theta n. This is now a process on the index set. Okay. And our problem will be to prove that, first we need to find the right scale time scale over which our index process or sequence of index processes converges in law as n goes to infinity to a Markov process. And if we are lucky, we will try to say exactly the rates of this limiting Markov process. Okay? Good. Now let me tell you a third example, maybe more interesting, which I call the sticky. C-arranged process. Okay, this is an interacting particle system. This is just a Markov process, and it will tell you first the state space of this Markov process. So let me fix some finite set S. I will use this set S as my sites on which I will put some particles. Okay. Is it okay? Here my parameter n is the total number of particles. And again, I will think of n as something very large. The set of size is fixed here. So here, kappa or k is fixed. It doesn't depend on the on my parameter, my scaling parameter n. The set of configurations is, of course, the set of these vectors. Such that the sum of the coordinates, the components, is always equal to the scaling parameter n. Okay. So this is my sequence of state spaces. And now the rates of this Markov process is are the following. So in this interacting particle system, you will see a particle from a site X jumping to another site Y. So this is the kind of transitions in this Markov process. The transition in which configuration at which a configuration eta goes to another configuration in which you put one more particle outside y, so you have less one particle outside x, and this transition occurs at rate at a rate which depends on the two sites x y, and this dependency is quantified by this function r, by a function r which I will fix. It will not depend on the number of particles. I will fix this r, and depends on the number of particles, just in the number of particles at psi x, okay, in the site from which the particle is jumping. And this dependency will be quantified by this other function g. So here, the dynamics is well determined by these two functions, gx and r. Okay? Let me tell you about these two functions. So r here, okay, we'll need some space. Okay, let me put it. So r is just a number for each pair of sites. Okay, And so you can think of this R as the transition rates of some random walk on the finite set S, okay? So thinking of R in this way, in my example, I will require that R is an irreducible set of rates. It's irreducible on this set S, on this finite set S. So if R is irreducible, you know that you up to some constant, you have only one invariant measure for this R. So let me call mx. Let me call m this. So choose just one invariant measure. And let me call M this invariant measure, okay? Now, in my example, these functions gx for each side will be of course, they are functions defined on the positive or non-negative integer numbers because it's the number of particles. And at first, obviously, if you don't have a particle at the side x, you cannot see anything jumping from x. So gx of 0 must be 0. And now I will assume the following condition of gx. When as n goes to infinity, as the number of particles at the side x is going to infinity, this function gx is going is converging to the value of this invariant measure you fixed on the side x. Okay, I will assume that. Moreover, I will assume that when you multiply this this difference times n, this expression converges to a. Let me put it in another color. That will converge. This expression will converge to a number, which I will assume that is positive and actually is bigger than 1. Okay, this hypothesis will be important to me. This is essentially the reason for which I will observe this sticky behavior for the zero range process. So here is actually the reason for anything. I mean, the reason for which I will show you in one simulation the asymptotic behavior of this interacting particle system. But let me tell you something about that now. Okay, will you erase that? So since B is positive, then for n very large, gxn must be larger than mx. You agree with me? So this as n goes to infinity, I'm saying there that gx is converging to this number mx, which is fixed in my model. Okay. Let me Let me keep in mind one example of that. For example, obviously, an example of that is to take something like mx plus. Let me write here the parameter with this color over n, no? Obviously. So this number gx of n is converging to mx, and since the limit of this expression is positive, then I can say that this is this sequence is essentially almost everywhere larger than mx, okay, over the mx. So let me say gxn is, this is not exactly true, but essentially is a decreasing function. So for this reason, let me say, this is not exactly what is happening here, but let me say that, suppose that this is actually the function gx, okay? This is the expression of the function gx. So in this configuration, for example, if you see a set x from in which the number of particles is very, very large, if compared with the other sides, then with a very very small probability, you will choose one particle from this side to move it to the to other sides. Okay, the probability that you choose this side to move a particle is very short if this number of particles is large. Okay, it's not too short, because actually it's converging to mx, which is always positive. Yeah, the process. This set of rates is irreducible, so this is always positive. Okay, so it's not too strong, this difference, but okay, in a weakly sense, you see that with a very small probability, you will take a particle in a site x which has a very large number of particles. Okay, so suppose that you start now your, I didn't give a name for my process. So here my, let me put this name, eta n. This is my sticky C-range process. So this is the Markov process. With these rates, okay? So suppose now that you start your C-range process, your sticky C-range process, just as I defined here, with all the particles in only one side. Okay? So I can tell you that, okay, I simulated that, so I actually saw that. If you start in this configuration, you will see that just a few particles will jump to other sides. And then instantaneously, these particles in the other sides, they will want to jump. They will jump, and eventually these particles will return to this site. So that will be so it will be very, very difficult to break this pseudo equilibrium. This will be very difficult to see the process escaping from this neighborhood of the configuration with which all the particles at site x. So let me write like that. It's okay this time. I don't how come not. But it's finished. Yeah, it's okay. Okay, let me just write that in this general setting. Okay, so what I'm telling here is that for each site here, you have a sequence of neighborhoods of this configuration. Yes. So this neighborhood is a set of configurations of m particles, so that the density of particles at the site x is almost one. Here, this is a sequence conversion to zero. This is not possible, sorry. Okay. So these are like very small macroscopic neighborhoods of this configuration in the state space. Yes? So let me draw a picture. If this rectangle is my state space, you have here some configuration of particles. For example, this configuration of particles is the configuration in which all the particles are inside one. Here, all the particles are inside two. Here, all the particles are inside three, and so on. And then here, I'm defining neighborhoods of these configurations. Yes, so I'm calling this the subset E1, this is the subset E2, this is the subset E1, E2, this is 3, this is 4. And I will see as an application of the tools I will give you in the course that here these subsets for this example of Markov processes are Wells. These are Wells for dynamics. Okay. But here we observe a difference with my other example. Now you have another subset. Let's say that is the subset in which you are not sure if the most power of particles are inside X or Y or Z. And this, and what we will prove is that, okay, I will try to prove that they are Wells. So if you start inside, for example, this subset, this well, you will remain there for a long, long time, for a very long time. We will try to compute, to estimate this time, actually. And I can tell you that this time will depend, actually, on this parameter B. Very similar to my earlier example. Here, we need to speed up the processes in this time scale, n to the b plus 1. This is something that, OK, this is something that I will prove. And have we proved that this delta set, it's a subset of state space in which the Markov process spends a time which is very smaller compared with this time, n to the b plus 1. Okay, so we can say that when you speed up the process at this time scale, m to the b plus 1, you will see that you will reach some kind of equilibrium here, and then suddenly, I mean in a almost exponentially distributed time, you will escape from here, and you will fall into another well. And the time that you spent, Markov process spent on this subset will converge to zero. To zero when you are speeding up the process in this factor. Okay, so it's this jump is instantaneous, but instantaneous compared with this time scale. Okay, and in this example, I will actually give you exactly what are the rates of these jumps on the wells. And just to finish, let me tell you that. So I will put in my general setting also a delta set. Sorry. And in order to deal with this problem, that now we have, for example, now we have a delta set. So now we have to redefine this index process, yes? Because you are not here. You can. What happens if your process is in this delta set? How we define this index process? This is what we have to give an answer for that. And for this reason, I will need my second tool. So this is my first tool, and actually my main tool, the martingale problem. A second tool that I will give you a very precise little theory about that. I will use the trace process, which yesterday I read in the book of Yuval Peres that this is called, he called that the induced process. Okay, I will tell you some things where I find very nice, how this trace process interacts with some ingredients in potential theory, exactly the capacities. And capacity will be my tools that I will use for this exact example, okay, for my sticky storage process. So these are the ingredients that I will use explain with very, very precisely in my course, and I will try to answer this kind of problems. Basically, I will try to prove the convergence of a sequence of functions of Markov processes, which has no Markov, and we will see how we recover the Markov property in the limit, okay? Okay, thank you very much. I hope to see you tomorrow.